The first human landing systems in history to be developed by U.S. industry will take astronauts from lunar orbit to the surface and back again. As part of a NASA program that will select one or two commercial crewed moon landers, SpaceX is busy testing Starship and prototyping hardware, and most recently built and demonstrated an elevator, in a very short period of time. For its lunar lander design, SpaceX has pitched a variation on its Starship spacecraft. SpaceX is already on its 20th Starship prototype and has been regularly testing the craft. Many of the prototypes have so far crashed and exploded, with SN10, its 10th Starship prototype being the first to land, though it exploded shortly after landing. Just from the human landing system standpoint, we had 27 functional performance requirements that we asked the offers, including SpaceX. And we went through a very detailed design, technical design, construction standards, safety, as well as health and human performance work, and all of that was pulled together, and that shifted various aspects of their Starship. They were able to meet or exceed the items that we had, that we require for safe human landing. Known as the Human Landing System Program, NASA selected three providers, a Blue Origin-led consortium, Dynetics, and SpaceX, to build prototypes and compete for one or two follow-on contracts, back in April 2020. SpaceX's Starship offering was deemed the riskiest solution, and the company received a middling $135 million, to Dynetics' $250 million, and the National Team's $570 million. For their $820 million investment, it's unclear what exactly NASA has gotten from its two best-funded teams, aside from paperwork. A few completed design reviews, and two low-fidelity mock-ups mostly made out of cardboard, foam, and wood. Meanwhile, in the 1.5 years, since SpaceX received its $135 million, the company has built no less than 11 full-scale Starship prototypes. Performed a dozen or more wet dress rehearsals and static fires with said prototypes, and performed two powered hops and two high-altitude test flights, and two times full-stack Starship now. To add to that list of low-cost achievements, SpaceX has also built and tested a functioning prototype of the elevator Starship would use to lift and lower astronauts to and from the lunar surface. SpaceX's proposal is certainly a unique one, with Starship being no less than several times taller and heavier than both its prospective competitors. However, Blue Origin's extraordinarily complex three-stage, four-component lander, requiring a separate transfer stage, descent stage, ascent stage, and crew cabin, makes even Starship seem somewhat reasonable. Notably, that massive 8 to 10m stack of separate spacecraft, crew cabin at the peak, would force NASA astronauts to transit a several-story ladder to and from the lunar surface. Far taller than the Apollo program's lander ladder, which NASA was already somewhat tepid on at the time, navigating a tall ladder in a clumsy, imprecise lunar EVA spacesuit would be extremely challenging and relatively risky. Dynetics is by far the least concerning solution in that regard, requiring what amounts to a footstool relative to SpaceX and Blue Origin. In the national team's defense, SpaceX's elevator approach is also undeniably risky, and it's safe to say that demonstrated reliability would be an absolute necessity for NASA to ever accept that solution. Of course, SpaceX could feasibly include a hand-cranked backup system and a ladder on Starship's exterior in the event of total system failure. But both backups would still pose risks similar to or greater than the national team's ladder. However, the fact that SpaceX has already built and begun testing a Starship moon elevator prototype makes it hard to believe that the company couldn't ultimately produce a safe, reliable, redundant elevator between now and the mid to late 2020s. On a separate note, it's unclear when or where SpaceX built and tested the first Starship elevator. The photo NASA provide appears to show an elevator prototype situated inside a steel Starship ring with the sky visible. But nothing like that setup has been spotted at SpaceX's Boca Chica Starship factory, or former Cocoa Beach production facilities. That leaves its Hawthorne, California factory or, perhaps, a mysterious, Roberts Road, facility on Kennedy Space Center land. Either way, it certainly appears that SpaceX has yet to show all its cards, and is doing everything it can to convince NASA that Starship is worth additional HLS contracts. NASA award contracts for full up moon lander demonstrations to SpaceX. SpaceX's newly announced Moon Starship is a fairly radical departure from the Mars-focused, fully reusable vehicle the company has been pursuing for years. Unintuitively, that may be the perfect half-step towards truly reusable Mars rockets. On April 30, NASA announced that SpaceX had won $135 million to design and build a highly customized variant of its reusable Starship spacecraft. With the intention of launching a handful of space agency astronauts to the moon in the mid-2020s. Whether or not that initial seed translates into enough funding to seriously design and build the ship SpaceX has shown off in new renders. It has already broken the ice, so to speak, between the US federal government, or at least NASA, and the company's ambitious next-generation launch vehicle. With a substantial amount of money now on the table for SpaceX to begin initial work on its moon Starship. It's worth analyzing just how different it is from the Starship the company is working on today. First and foremost, perhaps the most obvious difference between SpaceX's base Starship and its lunar variant is the rocket's hull. In the case of the moonbound ship, SpaceX appears to have returned to a fully painted vehicle for unknown reasons. More likely than not, that white paint is likely motivated by the fact that proposed NASA moon landers must be capable of landing and safely returning their astronaut cargo back into lunar orbit. To do that, those landers must be able to sit on the surface of the moon after landing for at least several days, with longer stays being even better. For Starship, this means that the vehicle must likely be able to keep its cryogenic liquid methane, an oxygen propellant, from warming up and turning into gas, thus preventing it from igniting its main Raptor engines. White paint is at least a bit more reflective, and thus insulating compared to Starship's shiny steel hull. But it could also hint at the use of more extensive insulation than sealed off with paint. This ties into perhaps the most significant functional change to the rocket. While visible in a render of the craft after landing on the moon, a separate render just before touchdown fully revealed not only the addition of large vacuum-optimized retrothrusters, but a major strategic shift in how Lunar Starship will attempt to land on the moon. In short, it appears that SpaceX does not plan on propulsively landing Lunar Starship on the moon, under the power of its main Raptor engines. Instead, three triple thruster clusters, likely relying on the same methane and oxygen propellant as Raptor, will fire up shortly before touchdown to gently land Starship on the moon. This approach has significant benefits. The moon's gravity is so low (1/6 of Earth's) that using even just one engine as powerful as Raptor to land would be incredibly difficult. A single engine could theoretically lift a fully fueled Starship thanks to low lunar gravity. Thanks for watching this video, and it's a super interesting topic. If you like this, make sure to subscribe. If you have any crazy ideas about what we should cover in next video, please comment it below, and we'll see if we can get to it. So thanks again for watching and goodbye.